My slides have been seen?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to present my topic. And today's my topic is management of intracranial hemorrhages in patients with anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs. In the present day, most common drugs which are being used by almost everybody are antihypertensives, anti-diabetic, antiplatelet drugs, and statins. As our hospital is famous for cardiac services, we get to see a lot of patients on using antiplatelet drugs and anticoagulants. All age groups of patients undergo cardiac surgeries in our hospital. Either they have mechanical valves and they must anticoagulation is a must for them. Ischemic heart disease and stroke prevention for most of them are put on antiplatelet drugs. Though biological valves do not require anticoagulation, arrhythmias and pacemakers necessitate their usage. These complications come back to us, so we have to deal with them. So most often these patients, they come back to us and we treat their complications. So those patients come to the cardiologist and cardiologists in turn refer to us. What are the issues in these patients? Expanding hematoma is a very common thing. The patient comes with a small hematoma within few hours, the hematoma will be expanded. Reversal of these drugs, how to do and how much to be given. When to restart, when you suspect a recurrent hematoma, a thrombotic event which is there has to be addressed, and other complications if there are any has to be addressed. The patient is a diabetic, these days is a very common practice. A patient goes to a physician, patient is a diabetic and hypertensive, even if he's less than 40 years old, if he has a slight increase in cholesterol, he's put on antiplatelet drugs. If the patient complains of slight giddiness and he goes to a doctor, he's put on antiplatelet drugs. Such patients who are very young, they are prone for injuries in their day-to-day activities and also in the road accident. So we have to be very cautious in starting the patients on antiplatelet drugs and tell them, educate them to tell their doctors if they have any problems, any surgical interventions if they have to undergo. They have to tell their doctors that they are being on these particular drugs. So the risk of intraoperative bleeding and postoperative recollection of hematoma is
Hey.
So it has to be tailored according to the need of each individual patient, how these drugs have to be reversed and when to restart them safely depending on their underlying condition for which these drugs are started and how safely we can restart without causing a risk of a re-bleed. Some patients can be both on anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs who carries the maximum risk of expansion of the hematoma and having a thrombotic event if they are stopped. The consent and prognosis, what happens these days when we see patients, patients' relatives expect 100% guarantee that the patient should come back home and he should not have any problem, which is not possible in such situations. Explain clearly what happens if he is not operated. Explains what can happen when they are operated. Explain about the poor prognosis regarding mortality and morbidity. Patient can die, even patient can die on the table, patient can have morbidity like a hemiplegia. These things have to be explained. Complications like a thrombotic event. The patient relatives don't care whether he died because of surgery or because of a stuck cardiac valve. They blame the surgeon who has done the particular surgery on the particular day. So general complications of patients in an unconscious state are very, very important. Explain to them about the ventilator and ventilator-related infections, etc. All these things have to be explained to the patient relatives before you take the patient. So types of hemorrhage, it could be spontaneous, maybe because of hypertension, they can have a spontaneous hemorrhage, or because of overdosage of these anticoagulant drugs, or wrong usage, they can have an intracranial hemorrhage. It could be a traumatic hemorrhage or it could be iatrogenic. These days, thrombolytic agents were using quite often, both in cardiac as in ischemic strokes. But today, that is not the topic of the day. We'll discuss in the later. The location of hematoma. The location could be anywhere. It could be extradural, it could be subdural, it could be intracerebral, ventricular, or subarachnoid. wherever at all planes you can have hematomas in these patients. What is the common problem? The patients on anticoagulants, after a certain period of usage, they take it for granted. They stop getting their PK, INR being levels being checked. They stop coming to the hospital, but one fine day they'll be found unconscious and they'll be brought to the hospital. They consume food which were told to them not to consume, like green leafy vegetables, tomatoes, other things, but they consume them and their anticoagulation goes haywire and they'll be again brought to an unconscious state. Some patients are erratic and they don't take their antihypertensive medication, because of which they'll have a high blood pressure and have a bleed at the time. They can have comorbidities, because most of these patients with hypertension can have a renal problem, or in addition can have a liver problem, because most often they are also on alcohol abuse. So such patients can have other problems as well. So staying alone, some patients these days, we find them most often they're staying alone or in old age homes. That others will not know what medications they are on. So when they're brought to the casualty, they have to make sure that these medications, what they are taking, you have to really look for the prescription or older charts and then know what exactly they are on. What do we do? Whenever a case comes to the emergency, with or without history of trauma, we get in addition ask for PT, APTT, and INR and platelet count. Repeat a CT scan. If the scan is done elsewhere for more than 6 hours back, it has to be repeated. In addition, if the history is available regarding comorbidities, LFT and renal parameters are checked. ECG and 2D echo is a must for all these patients. When should we be cautious? Most often in the middle of the night, we get a call from the casualty that's saying that there's a patient with a small intracranial bleed. The pill will be sent on WhatsApp, with no history. The duty doctor just gives the call and says, "This is a situation. Pupils are normal, sir. What should I do?" Because there's no history, we have not seen the patient in the middle of the night. They say, "Okay, manage conservative." Within next 3 hours, we get a call from the hospital saying that the patient is decelerating and having a fixed quality. Here we have to be extremely cautious. Make insist your duty doctor to take the history of any of these drugs being used or not. If they are being used, you have to expect it. Any older age group patient with a scalp hematoma and ecchymosis over the body or on the face, you think of suspect of these used drugs being used and get an investigation done without fail, and also admit them. All patients with history of antiplatelet, anticoagulant drugs, even if the CT scan is normal, needs to be observed for minimum 24 hours. If not, do a CT scan again within 6 hours, and if GCS continues to be 15 by 15, these patients can be discharged safely. What are the role of residual CT scans? Most often patient relatives suspect us. They say the minute we got one CT scan done, again you wanted to done in your hospital, explain to them what is very, very important, because these hematomas can expand. Patient on these drugs, the hematomas expand within a period of 3 to 4 hours. Also, sometimes we see their hematoma expanding. So all patients, whether either with a small or no hematoma, in any of the planes, a repeat CT scan is a must. If there is a decrease in level of sensorium, if they have comorbidities, if there's a fracture of a skull, these patients should be reinvestigated with a CT scan. 6 to 12 hours after the first scan, look for an expanding hematoma. It can be even at an earlier than 6 hours also. If the INR is very high, even the hematoma can expand in a much earlier time itself. What are the high risk for thrombogenesis? Some patients are really high risk. Some people are just like that, are started on anticoagulants, or antiplatelet drugs. However, there are certain group of patients which require definitely anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs. Which are this group of patients? Patient with mechanical valves. Sometimes there'll be two valves which change, both mitral and aortic. Such patients definitely needs anticoagulants. Pneumatic heart disease, atrial fibrillation, left atrial thrombosis, left atrial assist device, stroke within last 3 months with or without atrial fibrillation, active cancer in the body, venous thromboembolic phenomenon within last 6 months, or with severe thrombophilia, these patients need to be on antithrombotic agents. Lupus, antithrombic deficiency, all these cases require pre and post-operative bridging with heparin or low molecular with heparin. Before and after the surgery, these things are must. For an elective surgery, bridging has to be done. Stop the anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs. Do a bridging with low molecular weight or heparin. Stop them before 12 hours before surgery in an elective condition, or in an emergency condition. we have to reverse the drugs, and then again at the just to restart the drug, we have to do a bridging with a low molecular weight heparin or heparin. What are the routine tests which are done for the coagulation? Earlier days, all surgeries were being done with bleeding time and clotting time. But however, bleeding time and clotting time are found to be not relevant for any of these bleeding disorders. So they are not routinely being practiced because they are individual dependent and cannot be standardized. Prothrombin time is the one which is done routinely for extrinsic pathway. Activated partial thromboprostin time or APTT is done for both direct and common pathways. Thrombin time is done for fibrinogen deficiency or heparin is being used. And serum fibrinogen levels are also checked. And international normalized ratio or INR, which is routinely called, has to be done as a routine coagulation test. And we get mostly PT, APTT, INR in emergency settings. So special coagulation studies. So these are to mention, most of them are not available routinely in most of the hospitals and they're not being routinely be done. But we know what are the tests which should be available. One is platelet aggregation test is one important if there are antiplatelet drugs. Assay for factor inhibitors, factor activity assays involved. Already patient has been diagnosed with a von Willebrand disease. The tests which are required for that particular disease have to be done. Lupus antigen testing example, valuetrostat hypervenin time. All these things have to be done in case we know what exactly is the patient having prior to taking him for any of the elective or emergency surgical procedure. So what are the types of antiplatelet drugs? As you all know, we routinely use only aspirin and clopidogrel. But to complete, there are all so many other newer drugs which are available. Clopidogrel, prasugrel, ticlopidine, tegaclar, pancrelar, all these things are available in the markets. Some of the cardiologists use the common ones are aspirin and clopidogrel. So types of anticoagulant drugs. Routine drugs which are routinely used are anti-vitamin K antagonists, or which are warfarin acetrom. In most of the patients, these drugs are being used, especially in the cardiology. In a patient in a valve replacement setting, warfarin and acetrom are the commonly used drug at a dose of 1, 2, or 3 milligrams, depending on their INR. Generally, they want the patients to be, INR should be minimum between 2 and 2.5. So for them, the best drugs for them is acetrom and warfarin, which is used. And how do you monitor them? You have to do a PT and INR. And if you want to antagonize that particular drug, we can use vitamin K, FFP, or PCC. So again, unfractionated heparin for so many conditions we use, or during studies, heparin also being used. It has to be given parenteral. APTT has to be monitored. Protamine sulfate is the antagonist for it. And if there's a low molecular weight heparin, which have been used, exactly, they are deltaparin, hexaparin, tesaparin. All are given parenterally and all can be reversed by given protein. And anti 10M Fondaxparin is parenteral, Rivaroxaban, Apixaban. These are the drugs which are being routinely used now during the COVID period. Most people are put on oral anticoagulants. These are the drugs which are being used and they can be only reversed by factor, four factor PCC. If not, they have to give them only FFPs have to be given to this patient. Direct thrombin inhibitors. Dabigatran is oral. It can be reversed by etanercizumab or four factor and other drugs are also there mentioned. So this is the, as you all know about the clotting mechanism and the coagulation, which we have studied during our physiology days. This is a common pathway which has been used. After the platelet aggregation, coagulation pathway comes into so there are various studies have shown how to use, how to reverse. This is one of the very good paper in Neurology India from NIMHANS as well as from St. John's Medical College. This is one paper which has given extensively about how to reverse these things and also the other papers which have studied how to reverse the particular thing. But all these papers are whatever said and done, all these have to be done individually for individual patients. Another important thing, steps in the management are always involve your cardiology colleague so that an urgent ECG and 2D echo has to be done to know his cardiac status before surgery. Some patients could be in cardiac failure state. Unless you know prior to it, if you overload the patient, these patients can never die. So you have to involve your cardiologist all through the, during the treatment, all the cardiologists should be involved. This gives some information regarding the cardiac valve status, if any, and any aerodynamic signals in the heart. These are present. When to restart the this anticoagulant, you can always do it in consultation with a cardiologist and an anesthetist. Pre-op anesthetic check is mandated. Control of hypertension is very important. Sometimes if the patient has so many comorbidities, the anesthetist might give GA. Sometimes we may have to even do local anesthesia, we may have to operate. In such high-risk cases, informed consent and video consent, as I mentioned earlier, is very important. These days, the patient dies, all the patient relatives make a big ruckus in the hospital. We have to tell them about the death and their disability before you take the patient to theater. General principles of reversal. So, how do we reverse these drugs? This is what is important before you take the patient to surgery. So, in any elective surgery, stop anticoagulants 5 days prior to surgery. Some say 5 days, some say 7 days. Best is to wait for 7 days of anticoagulants and then take the patient to surgery. But if it's a high-risk case, you may have to put a bridging, as I mentioned earlier, with low molecular weight heparin, which can be stopped 12 hours prior to surgery. In antiplatelet drugs, aspirin can be stopped for 5 days and clopidogrel can be stopped for 7 days, and you can safely take the patient for surgery. But in emergency situations, these drugs also have to be reversed. Control hypertension around 150 millimeters of mercury before surgery is also mandatory. So the antiplatelet drugs, how to reverse them? Only aspirin, some studies says no need for transfusion of platelet if the platelet count is normal. However, it is safe to give transfused platelets before surgery, because sometimes we feel right from the time you mark the incision on the scalp with a needle, the scalp keep on oozing. It will be definitely more than the normal. Such patient definitely, unless you give them platelet transfusion during surgery, you will find very difficult to control the bleeding. On dual antiplatelet drugs like aspirin and clopidogrel, some studies suggest also no transfusion. However, this is very, very difficult to accept. These patients definitely require intraoperative homeostasis. For them, we need to give them transfusion with either a single donor platelets or 4 to 6 pooled platelets 3 hours prior to surgery. This is very, very important. Sometimes when you give a platelet transfusion, the platelets should have been given overnight and then you take the patient for surgery in the morning. It is not correct. Once the platelets are given, these platelets can be deactivated by the already existing antiplatelet drugs. So just 3 hours prior to surgery, you have to give them transfusion. And during surgery also, this transfusion has to be given. At times, even 10 units of multi-donor platelets may be required. And if you want to potentiate the platelets, TDVAP can be given at a dose of 0.3 micrograms per kg. And be given this potential platelet aggregation. This is available and it can be given. The bleeding is not getting controlled. Activated factor 7 can be given, but sometimes it will be available, sometimes it is not available. General principles for reversal of anticoagulation. How do you reverse anticoagulants? So for anti-vitamin K agents, warfarin and acetrom, IV vitamin K is the drug of choice. It has to be given for a minimum of 3 to 4 days. After the surgery, during surgery, and after pre-operative and post-operative, it can be given. Fresh frozen plasma can be given. 3-factor or 4-factor prothrombin complex concentrate can be given. What do they contain? Factor 2, 9, 10, and 7 are available. Then sometimes in 3-factor, 7 is not available. So most often in neurosurgical cases, 4-factor PCC is what is routinely recommended. PCC has got 4 times faster action than FFPs. But for novel anticoagulants, what are the drugs which are, as I mentioned earlier, rituximab for decarbamazepine or hemodialysis has to be done. If the patient has consumed the drug just 2 hours prior to surgery, activated charcoal can be given to prevent adsorption. And adenexate alpha can be given for rivaroxaban and apixaban. And FFPs can also be co-administered for these drugs. Monitor the INR to bring it down to 1.5 before surgery. So unfractionated heparin can be reversed by protamine at a dose of 1 milligram for 100 units. Low molecular weight heparin are resistant to protamine. Only 50% reversible is possible for these drugs. So sometimes you may have to give them FFPs also. And also if the PCCs are available, 10 ml of PCC is equal to 600 ml of FFPs. So if the patient is going to have an overload because of PCC, FFP, FFPs, the PCCs can be given safely, and that even sometimes it can even result in a thrombotic event. So we have to be very careful when giving a PCC and FFPs. So in either PCC or 4 PCC are not available, how do you manage this patient? First, start with 2 units of FFP by rapid infusion. Check INR after 15 minutes. If the INR is still above 1.5, repeat 2 more units. Add low priority if you think there is an overload is a concern. The number of units depends on the INR at the start. So
all the things have been added, some things are 7.
And at that times, you have to
give vitamin.
You have to give vitamin. All these things have to be given.
Along with the claim intimation.
Those of
having all the
things. IV or and not only is it how to stop these drugs or reverse these drugs, at the same time, we have to reinstitute these drugs so that they don't get a thrombotic event. So, in a low risk patient, how do you give this and restart the drugs? Antiplatelet drugs can be started, repeat a CT scan post op after 24 hours. Some say you can restart the drug within 48 hours. But the anticoagulants, you can repeat a CT scan if there is no hematoma. Restart with low molecular weight heparin after 72 hours and then convert it to warfarin. High risk thrombotic events, the patient, as I mentioned earlier in the group, if the patient has got high risk for thrombotic events, antiplatelet drugs can be given 6 hours post after a 6 hour post op CT scan. If there is no clot, you can restart them after 12 hours, start with low dose aspirin. Anticoagulants after 6 hours post op, if there is no clot, we start with low molecular weight heparin and convert to warfarin. This is what's called bridging. Recheck the CT scan as and when required, and in case of any deterioration, repeat a scan immediately. In patients with mechanical heart valves, always advised to get a 2D echo as and when required to see the status of the valve. Whatever you have done a major surgery, craniotomy, and if the patient dies of a stuck valve, still you will be blamed for the surgery which you have done. So it's always better to involve everybody and tell them this is what you have to do. And now coming to the individual hematoma areas, hematomas, extradural hematoma, it can be seen in both groups of patients, either on antiplatelet drugs or anticoagulants, and it mostly seen post-trauma. It can also happen in some patients on anticoagulants, but most common problem is trauma is involved. Hematoma expansion is very fast in patients on anticoagulants. Within 1 hour to 2 hours, you may have a large hematoma in these patients. Intraoperative ooze is a problem in patients on antiplatelet drugs. Craniotomy can be done only after reversal and platelet transfusion has to be given to these patients. Evacuation of clot should be complete. Adequate hemostasis has to be achieved and heat stitches have to be placed. Leave a subgaleal drain close to the butthole site so that if there is any recollection there, it can be sucked out with a closed suction drain. A repeat CT brain can be done, and before discharging, definitely a scan has to be done and restart the anticoagulation antiplatelet drugs. Watch for 2 days and then send the patient home, but ask them to come for review within a week's time. Acute subdural hematoma always requires an emergency craniotomy. In case the brain edema is very severe, it maybe has to be combined like a decompressive craniotomy. And this has to be done only after adequate reversal. Again, repeat CT scan after 12 hours, or in case of any pupillary changes or worsening sensorium, do a repeat scan immediately. Always leave a subgaleal drain in these patients also. Some can have an addition to contusion, which can expand and may require evacuation again. I'll show you an example of what we've done very recently. So this patient came with a patient with GCS was 15 by 15. He came with an acute subdural hematoma with mild weakness in one side. So we did a scan. After that, we took him for, we did the reversal and took him for surgery. We did a craniotomy and evacuated the clot. If you notice, there's a small temporal contusion there. There's a small temporal contusion. And within the next 1 day, the second post-op day was fully alert. By night, he became drowsy. When we repeated a scan, there's a large temporal hematoma. So again, we took the patient for surgery. And we did a small temporal craniectomy. The top, you can see the craniotomy above. Below that, we did a small temporal craniectomy, evacuated the clot completely, and we could discharge the patient after restarting anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs after 1 week. So chronic subdural hematomas and acute or chronic subdural hematomas. mostly seen in patients with antiplatelet rest. Almost I can say nowadays, very boldly I can say that every third patient with chronic subdural hematomas are on antiplatelet rest. And invariably, unless we give them platelet transfusion, if you operate, recurrence is becoming very, very common. So we have to give them antiplatelet drugs before taking the patient for surgery. With the history of recent trauma, it can vary on acute and chronic subdurals. So some can have a thick membranes and the subdural could be multilocated. If the patient comes with a simple chronic subdural hematoma, wait for an adequate period, stop the antiplatelet drugs, and then you can safely operate. The patient is deteriorated recently or come with an altered sensorium, then you have to do a platelet transfusion and you can do Burfo's either under local or GA. But leave a subganglion. This is what we have found has done a lot of changes in our outcome. Always leaving a subganglion drain just across the two Burfo's and wait for 48 hours until there is no drainage from this thing on the side. With these patients, the recurrence rates have come down drastically. Also, acute and chronic multilocated subdural hematomas, they require a craniotomy. Plan a craniotomy, keep all the entire protocol has to be followed for reversal, and then surgery can be done by excising the membrane and following the same protocol. At times, what happens, these patients are so old and they are having so many comorbidities, you may have to do it under local anesthesia. A small mini craniotomy is done, and the excision of the membranes has been done and the clot can be evacuated. If you have an endoscope with you in your hospital, this can be used to look for the corners somewhere where there's a hematoma, those can be also be evacuated with an endoscope assist. A repeat scans before discharge and restart platelet drugs after 1 week. So this is the example of a small mini craniotomy which we have done recently. The patient came with a multilocated chronic subdural hematoma with, you can see the very thick membrane it was present and it was multilocated. So and this patient was a poor risk for general anesthesia. So we had to do it under local anesthesia. Just we gave a linear incision, did a mini craniotomy, excised the membranes and evacuated the clot. The brain became lax and then we could discharge him after 1 week. So intraventricular bleeds. We prefer to do a CT angio in all patients. Recently also we have what happened, one patient was admitted with an intraventricular bleed, which was a small bleed we thought will manage conservatively, was admitted under neurologist. He said, okay, manage conservatively. But unfortunately, the patient did not undergo contrast CT nor had an angiogram. After 1 month, she had a re-bleed, which we got an angiogram then had an AVM. So we cannot rule out any bleed. It's better to do an angiogram. Without angiogram, if you say safely everything is normal, it's difficult to say. If aneurysm or AVM is seen, treat it accordingly. If there's a small bleed with no hydrocephalus, no intervention. The large bleed filling all the ventricles and early hydrocephalus, external ventricle drainage is a treatment of choice. Till the fluid is clear, you have to keep the drain with adequate antibiotic prophylaxis and CSF cultures. Change it to Ommaya reservoir. Once the fluid is clear, you can always change it to Ommaya reservoirs after 3 to 4 days. Repeat a CT scan if the ventricular dilatation is still persisting or if the patient requires repeated aspirations from the Ommaya reservoir. And if the CSS has become clear, then you can convert into a ventricular peritonation. During this period, anticoagulation is required. And if the patient has put on low molecular weight heparin, and which can be stopped 1 day prior to shunt surgery. So in spite of all this, patient has to be in a low molecular weight heparin if he has to go for a shunt surgery at a later date. So subarachnoid hemorrhage. In this, there is no doubt angiogram is a must. CT angio is preferred. However, mostly they would be normal in this patient. Why I said, because these can have a minor trauma, which they would have totally forgotten. And when you examine the patient, there may not be any bleed on the skull. But after the CT scan, everything is done. Then you start seeing the subgaleal ecchymosis. And then we feel, oh, unnecessarily we have done. But it is always better if the patient has a subarachnoid bleed. It could be traumatic subarachnoid bleed. But we have to do an angiogram to rule out an aneurysm. Mostly, there are managed conservatively with anti-edema measures and other protocols for subarachnoid hemorrhage. But if aneurysms are detected, surgery is a must or intervention depending on the feasibility and cost and individual choice. This is an example of a subarachnoid hemorrhage with an intraventricular bleed. This was what, as I said, we did an extraventricular drainage, converted into an Ommaya reservoir, and later we had to put in a shunt for this patient. So intracerebral hematomas, this is the most topic where we find it very, very difficult to operate, not to operate, size of the clot, shape, all these things come into play, whether it is traumatic, all traumatic ones we generally operate and work at, but if spontaneous and hypertensive, to operate or not to operate. But those who are on anticoagulants and antiplatelet drugs, definitely the hematoma is going to expand. So they're definitely, they don't even give you a time. Even before thinking, you have to take the patient to surgery. So it's, sometimes it happens like that. The patient relatives insist on surgery. You have to take them and do whatever is required, have to be done. The hypertensive could be either, it could be ganglionic, cerebellar, lobar, thalamic, intraventricular extension, brainstem, etc., etc. On anticoagulation and antiplatelet drugs, either of them or both of them, they can have a rapidly deteriorating sensory. Hematoma expansion is very common within a few hours. Needs emergency evacuation and decompressive craniotomy after adequate reversal. These patients are, by the time they come to the casualty itself, they'll be either on ventilator or they would have been intubated somewhere and sent to the hospital because this patient was treated earlier in the same hospital. So when they are on ventilator, we'll have some time to do the reversal, give all the FFPs and antiplatelet prophylaxis, whatever have to be given, it can be given. If you think the patient is going to have a low GCS post-op, or if it's going to be on a prolonged ventilation, it's better to do a tracheostomy in the same sitting to avoid another surgery and another reversal at the later date. So you plan and tell for consent for tracheostomy also in the same sitting. During the surgery, what we do? Decompressive craniotomy or evacuation clot or both, depending on the swelling at the time of surgery on the table. So intraventricular bleed, if it is there, you can do an UVD on the other side or at the same side. And another thing what we have noticed is, if you use bipolar coagulation too much and aggressively suck out the clot, postoperatively these patients can have persistent neurological deficit which may not improve at all. If you don't use bipolar too much and just gently take out the clot by irrigation and sucking out the clot as it comes out, these patients definitely we have noticed have a better outcome than those who have not, we have done too much of sucking. Entire clot need not be evacuated. Some people say you have to evacuate the entire clot. That's also not required. You can wait. Once the brain becomes lax and pulsating, you can stop the surgery and you can come back. Either replace the bone plug or do not replace the bone plug, depending on your choice. At times, if the flow seal is available, it's a very good option because it contains thrombin that can achieve hemostasis better. Now, if it's not available, you can use Surgicel. In urgent situations, mini craniotomies and plaque reduction, this is what we used to practice in IMHANS when we were students there. We used to do a mini craniotomy, evacuate the clot as a life-saving measure, and general request good follow-up scans and look for recurrences. So this is one of the examples of intracerebral bleed, which with the ventriventricular extension and there's a large ventricular dilatation also. So this patient, we did a craniotomy and then later put him on an EVD and convert it into a Meyer reservoir. So this is what evacuation of clot, even those craniotomy is small, the bone plaque could not be replaced, so we removed the bone plaque. The same another case, intraventricular extension, total evacuation of the clot has been done. So to conclude, anticoagulants and antiplatelet usage is becoming more and more common these days, and with their associated complications are also becoming very common. Management depends on individual patients. So despite whatever the studies give, guidelines say, each patient is different. Each patient can have different comorbidities. Each patient's weight, all so many things can be there in addition to whatever is being said in the studies. So such patient requires individually tailored management. Patient outcome is what matters. See, you say I operated the patient, gone back home is different. I operated the patient, that is different. So what matters to the relatives is he alive or dead? Is he able to do his daily activities or not? Unassisted or is bedridden? This is what matters to the relatives. The quality of life is what is most important to the relatives. When the patient is, especially on an older age group, in the patient, whether he has to be assisted every day for his day-to-day activities, they sometimes say, why did you make the patient alive? You would have left him alone, he would have died. It would have been much more easy for us. There are times patient relatives have come and said, had you not intervened, you could have been much more happier than after you have intervened. So these things are very, very important in these cases. You have to be vigilant at all stages in the perioperative period for a successful outcome. So outcome depends on right from the time the patient has come to casualty till he discharged. To prevent a thrombotic event, you have to restart, stop the anticoagulation, restart. So whatever, all, at all stages, unless you are vigilant and it's a team effort, it's not a single man show. You have to involve your cardiologist, you have to involve your intensivist, and also you have your anesthetist for the successful outcome of this patient. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan.
Thank you, Dr. Mohan, for the excellent talk.
Thank you.
Thank you for making the most difficult day in daily practice cases of anticoagulation and anti-platelet drugs usage and reversal, taking the consent and up to management and up to discharge. Thank you a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Mohan, can I ask you some question?
Sure. Go ahead.
In the thrombotic workup, when you expect an acute thrombotic episode in a case, can we include homocysteine levels also in that if you have time? Serum homocysteine levels.
It can be done. Yes, see, basically, the thrombotic events are routinely done by the neurologist and cardiologist. They generally look at
as a surgeon. Here we have a case and we have some time, as you said. And one more thing is, in an emergency situation where we don't have time, can given that there is no time to give any reversal agents.
Yeah.
Can the general hemostatic the drugs that are used in general surgery are gynec, like etamslate or tranexamic acid?
We started our practice in about 30 years back. Myself and Dr. Sridhar, we were made to operate on one of the patients on anticoagulant drugs without any of these things available. You literally cry on the table. The patient will bleed like anything. You cannot stop. Ultimately, we have to shove in big cotton balls into the brain and come out because you just notice that blood will be just pouring out. None of that is of any use. Unless you reverse it, you take the patient, you literally lose the patient.
Hey, do you have any experience with this tranexamic acid and the etamslate and the electrics?
I'm not able to hear you, sir.
Like the hemostat that I used in the general surgery or gynecology.
Tranexamic acid and all these things, they don't much work in the patient on regular anticoagulants. Yes. They are little useful, but they're not of much use. And best is to give them FFPs only. Because other things are also not available in most centers. PCCs are not available. Only FFPs are
that's
available.
That's what I'm asking. They are not available here also.
Not available in most centers.
And one more thing is EVD.
Yeah.
In a hyperdense solid clot in the ventricles, with the hyperdense clot in the scan, does the EVD work really?
Sometimes they don't work, to be very frank. But we have to do is what we have to irrigate it sometimes. And by just doing that, sometimes what we routinely do is if the clot is on one ventricle, definitely put in the ventricle where there is no clot.
Put EVD when I see some CSF signal around the clot.
Yeah, because
it's a solid white clot, I don't even put EVD.
Some CSF is coming, will be definitely be coming down. Don't put on the tube in the clot. You try to place
that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying.
That there's some normal CSF.
Thank you, sir. Nice talk.
Thank you, sir.
Comprehensive coverage of a routine problem, actually. Very useful discussion.
Thank you, sir.
Very sick.
Any other questions?
No, sir. Carry on, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I don't have any questions.
Thank you.
The members or from the audience, yes. Is there any questions from the audience?
Any questions from the audience?
Mohan.
Yep, sir.
What type of cases you come across mostly?
Sir, for us in our hospital, we do a lot of this valve replacement. So most of them, we come with intracerebral bleeds only on anticoagulants. Antiplatelet drugs routinely seen in all chronic subdural hematomas. Nowadays, 1 in 3 patients are getting chronic subdurals on antiplatelet drugs in the older age groups.
Not many with the heart stents.
Stents are very rarely you do see, sir.
No, stent people also use anticoagulants in a milder dose.
Antiplatelet drugs, but the
mild doses.
As I said, routine patients who with come with intracranial bleeds are with anticoagulants. Fewer in the antiplatelet drugs. That's what I mean to say.
We here see mostly ICH and SDH.
Yeah.
Commonly.
Yes. Commonly ICH and SDH.
Yes, sir.
We frequently see intraventricular bleeds also, sir.
Yeah.
Apart from chronic SDH and acute on chronic SDH and ICH, we frequently see intraventricular.
That's why I described in all planes. We had experience with all the.
Including planes. SH.
Yes. All. Say, one scan I showed where there was subarachnoid bleed and intraventricular bleed, but there's no aneurysm.
Yeah, correct.